Mr. Wilson's resignation came as a shock not only to the public, but also...
This one is still left asking the question, why? Why now?
It has been a surprise, I think, to very many that it has happened quite so suddenly.
Why?
For over a decade, Harold Wilson had dominated the political scene, winning four general elections for Labour.
Once again, be plain Harold Wilson, MP.
When he suddenly resigned, people were asking, did he know something that we didn't?
I wish I could have been Prime Minister in happier times and easier times.
I can't believe this is really happening to me.
These were indeed tricky times for politicians.
Resolved that Richard M. Nixon, President of the United States, is impeached for high crimes and misdemeanors.
There can be no whitewash at the White House.
Wilson was not the first leader to quit midterm. 2 years before, President Nixon resigned when two journalists revealed that he was mired in a conspiracy to undermine democracy. The names Woodward and Bernstein and Watergate, Dirty Tricks and Deep Throat entered polite conversation.
God bless America.
While Britain was abuzz with speculation about Wilson's resignation, he secretly called two BBC journalists and gave them a scoop, what he called the British Watergate. He said that as Prime Minister, he'd been unable to run the country. Instead, powerful sections of the establishment had been working so hard to get rid of him, we had come within an inch of our very own military coup.
I still feel 30 years on and have to sort of just pinch myself to say, did this really happen? Talking about matters that were never made public before.
Whenever he goes there, people nudge him and they say that's CIA.
Yes.
But he went right to the top in CIA.
Fortunately, the journalists secretly recorded these conversations with their unimpeachable sources.
It became common knowledge that there was an awful lot of talk about coups.
Sections of the tapes, heard here for the very first time, have been dramatized. The words spoken by actors are the words Wilson and his closest ally, his political secretary Marcia Williams, spoke to the two journalists Barrie Penrose and Roger Courtieur. 30 years on, it's high time we told the story of an investigation which came close, but not close enough, to exposing the conspiracy to remove the elected Prime Minister.
As the big black spider in the corner of the room.
It all began on a quiet news day.
He's now being sought by Scotland Yard for allegedly trying to extort money from his former employers. Because that evidence he's collected of the undercover operation by South African business interests.
South African company are interested in British politics.
Hello?
Barrie Penrose?
Yes?
I'm calling from Harold Wilson's office.
Oh, yes?
Mr. Wilson wondered whether you might like to join him for drinks this evening.
Why, yes, of course.
Can we say at 6 o'clock, then? At 5, Lord North Street, just round the corner from the House of Commons.
Yes, that's fine.
Goodbye.
I was spellbound, really. And then phone back on the main switchboard number at Westminster, 219-3000.
Mr. Wilson's office.
Harold Wilson's office?
It's Barrie Penrose here at the BBC. Could I just confirm, forgive me, that I have an arrangement with Mr. Wilson at 6 p.m. this evening?
And the person, in fact, who picked up the phone was the same man who'd called me minutes earlier. He was a bit surprised why I was actually just checking, but I was just checking to make sure I wasn't the subject of an in-office hoax.
That's right. 6 p.m. at Lord North Street.
Jolly good.
Goodbye.
need a film crew.
Unless there will be organized threat to our democracy in this country, but to destroy the credence and standing of democratic politicians of whom they do not approve.
On what was to become the biggest day of their careers, the two young journalists drove to Wilson's home. Their film crew stayed nearby and waited.
Well, we drove up to Westminster, parked in Lord North Street, went along to number 5, and there was a policeman outside.
I mean, you're quite apprehensive at the same time. I mean, he's still a very powerful, important person. You may be walking into something where you're going to absolutely have nothing to deliver at all, and it could be quite embarrassing. So that's one side of it. And the other side of it is you're absolutely fingers crossed that there's a great story coming. But you don't know. You don't know. So it's quite an interesting journey.
There was still a mystery about why he'd resigned when he did. He was only 60. And left office long before people thought he would. So that was an ongoing mystery that needed to be solved.
Hello, sir.
Come in, come in.
Barrie Penrose.
And this is my colleague, Roger Courtieur.
What can I get you to drink?
Sherry, please. Dry, she should have got one.
Whiskey, please.
Water? Soda?
No, neat.
There you are. Did you read the speech I gave this afternoon?
I said then there is a need for journalism. Investigative journalism. What I have to say to you is of the utmost seriousness. Democracy as we know it is in grave danger.
Well, Roger and I have worked together on a number of investigations.
Prominent people are coming under attack. I think you as journalists should investigate the forces which are threatening democratic countries like Britain. The dirty tricks that have been going on against myself and also my government.
And when you say dirty tricks, sir, what exactly are you thinking of?
Oh, all those rumours. With Marsha, I am suing the Sunday Express. They said when the reason I resigned comes out, I'd be totally discredited. My lawyer said, get writs. If they fight it, you'll end up owning the Sunday Express. And that story about I'd received £1 million of uncut diamonds from South Africa. I've not seen them yet.
Wilson believed he'd been the victim of a conspiracy, and he had a highly unusual proposal for them.
Business groups and other anti-democratic agencies. These people are putting a whole idea of democracy at risk.
At very worst, what we have is an amazing insight into his last few months in office. What might have turned out to be the reason for the resignation might lie somewhere in what he was saying and what was gradually unfolding.
It was mind-blowing stuff, I mean, by any standards.
Our democracy needs protecting. Would you be interested? If you're a journalist, you know, what else would you be aiming for? What else would you find most exciting?
I think you will find an investigation rewarding. You can have free access to me. I will be able to guide you gently in the right direction. I will help you with leads and we can have regular meetings. But you must take care. No one must know that I am helping you. The telephone can't be trusted. Whatever you do, don't call me here. And you yourselves should be on your guard. You could well find yourselves coming in for some black propaganda. Express and so on.
Yes, of course.
I see myself as the big black spider in the corner of the room. Sometimes I may speak when I'm asleep. You too should listen. Occasionally when we meet, I might tell you to go to the Charing Cross Road and kick a blind man standing on the corner. That blind man could tell you something. Lead you somewhere. Lead you somewhere.
I see.
Well, we must meet again soon.
Yes, of course.
From now on, he'd be their secret source, their mole, their deep throat.
We'll start work on this immediately.
Coming out of that meeting, gulp of fresh air, it's one of those huge adrenaline rushes where you're grinning like a loon. And suddenly you're doing a little Irish jig in the street, going yippee, yippee. Because now you suddenly don't have to be on best behaviour, you're not worrying about making a fool of yourself in front of him. Wow. Amazing.
They sent the film crew home. Not really one for the evening news bulletin, this. What dark forces had driven the former Prime Minister into the arms of our journalists? Wilson had become Labour leader unexpectedly in 1963. In a Britain weighed down by the Cold War and the legacy of wartime austerity, he had cut a daringly modern figure with his trademark flat vowels, Mac and pipe. But he had made real enemies when he criticised the stranglehold on power exercised by the British establishment. Aristocrats who'd managed to run the nation in the time they could spare away from their country retreats.
I think our time is rather drawing to an end. We mustn't go on too long.
Well, the British establishment was a very close-knit society. People used to know each other. You were born, you were put down for eating. They would go to debutante balls, they would go to be in the same club. It was a structured society centering around the court, which meant something. It was a cradle-to-grave dependence on and relationship with the monarchy.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Queen.
What you might generally call nepotism, even corruption, was far from their mind. They didn't think they were nepotistic or corrupt. They thought it's the normal thing to do.
Wilson was opposed to the London establishment running things, and he was opposed to the fact that he thought they were inefficient, incompetent, as well as privileged.
Well done.
It seemed to me he was a modern man.
Mr. Chairman, I come to what we must do.
Suddenly, I was hearing, instead of the sort of Harold Macmillan, Grouse Moore image, here was a man who was talking the language of the 60s.
First, then, more scientists.
With an election imminent, Wilson had been gifted the opportunity not just to criticise the establishment, but to take their trousers down in public.
Oh!
A call girl's kiss-and-tell story of her antics with the Tory minister, John Profumo, shocked the public.
Mr. Profumo's morals are a great public issue.
Another political term was coined, the sex scandal.
The Profumo affair had everything. It had sex, politics, Russians, espionage, everything. And they saw this as a possible opportunity to besmirch the Tory government with the sex thing.
It gave Wilson a subject with massive media coverage, where the Tories were on the defensive and where people like Prime Minister Harold Macmillan looked totally inadequate at dealing with it because they were just uncomfortable with dealing with anything to do with a subject like sex.
It's really beyond belief.
Well, I'll make them this offer and they can consider it next week.
Too much tittering.
If they'll stop telling lies about us, we'll stop telling the truth about that.
What's it tittermongers here?
the establishment really felt Wilson hitting them below the belt.
Do you feel that those who've spoken out, the bishops, the Times and so on, have tried to turn it into a party?
I think you have.
Thank you, Lord Hill.
In elections, sleaze usually does the trick. Wilson was in Downing Street.
Though I lost, there was a tremendous sense of elation when I went back to St. Thomas's Hospital, looked across the river at the House of Commons and thought, well, Labour's now in control. Things are going to be different.
The new Prime Minister personifies the issues of his election campaign. He's the archetypal new man.
He said, you have to modernise, he said, modernise. He said, oh, get out. Modernise or get out.
And now from what I believe is the first electronically recorded interview in a train back to the studio in London.
One of the reasons why I was pleased that we had that Labour government is because the people who feel that they've got the right to run the country found that they weren't running the country. The people who felt that things were always going to go their way, whichever government was in office, found things that were not going their way.
That revolution cannot become a reality unless we are prepared to make far-reaching changes in economic and social attitudes.
So he took these people on expecting some opposition, but I think they underestimated the degree of opposition. They felt that the people whose privilege they were taking away, and doing it very successfully, were actually sniping behind them all the time, and that they still had an enormous amount of power.
For the BBC journalists, it was one thing to investigate a conspiracy on the scale of Watergate, another thing entirely to prove it.
To make sure that we had sufficient evidence that we would be credible when we tried to go public.
So we decided we'd use a tape recorder, in fact, a tape recorder in a briefcase.
If we weren't going to do that, we might just as well not bother going. It was essential. If you're going to do the job, do it properly. The least chance of detection, perfectly innocuous briefcase, same as you're carrying around all the time. Job done. The general principle at the BBC was if it was in the public interest, you would be allowed to do covert. It was not that big a decision. It was much more what happens if we get caught. I think was the thing certainly that was going through my mind. Will we effectively have blown the relationship?
See, when all this...
When all this began, Marshall always said there were two people. One was a Liberal candidate who always went to the Labour Party conferences. And whenever he goes there, people nudge one another and say, that's CIA. It's a standing joke that he represents the CIA.
One particular day with Wilson, three of us sitting there talking about one thing and another and what had happened in America.
The other calls himself a doctor, though he's not listed in the directory. This doctor called...
There was a terrible clonk on the tape recorder. And as the tape went round, there was a clonk and a clonk and a clonk.
And this doctor used to turn up at my political office in Westminster from time to time. It was difficult to get rid of him because he was friendly with some of my staff.
He didn't seem to notice this. Well, he didn't notice it at all, actually. He went on chatting away merrily in this heavy chunk, chunk, chunk.
And one day, I noted down the number on his registration plate.
He actually took his number plate?
Ooh. I passed it on to MI5. They said he was wanted for forgeries and theft, not a nice man. But they, for whatever reason, said that's all. They said that neither man was known in any sense to the American Intelligence and Security Service.
I see.
George Weidenfeld has contacts with the CIA. What happened next was, I said to George, just take these two names. And he went right to the top in CIA, and I got in writing that they were not CIA, were not in the current setup. But one of them was known to pretend to be CIA, but they knew all about it.
So they were phony, in fact?
Yes. Or they were working for some other intelligence agency. We don't know, do we?
No.
As good journalists, they were naturally a little skeptical.
Run a story.
Well, we banged on both their doors, in fact, spoke to both men, but they denied any truth in the allegations against them, and we couldn't take it much further forward.
A costly mistake. If they trusted their source and followed his lead, they'd have uncovered all there was to know about CIA dirty tricks against Wilson.
My man could tell you something, lead you somewhere.
Wilson seemed paranoid, but in the Cold War, paranoia was catching.
The Russian long-term aims are to dominate the free countries of Western Europe and to establish Russian leadership throughout the whole of Europe. Why are they doing this?
Who or what was feeding the paranoia? Of course, the genuine paranoid is spooked by his enemy within. If the journalists had traced this fear to its source, they would have stumbled upon one man, the key to the conspiracy against Harold Wilson. CIA head of counterintelligence, James Jesus Angleton.
I am mindful of the serious issues facing the committee.
He was a spooky character in every sense of the word. Jim Angleton, he had a sort of strange skeletal face. Angleton was fussed about the general instability of Britain. Was it governable or ungovernable? Were there a whole lot of Reds under the bed?
The Reds under and often in the bed were the Cambridge spies Burgess MacLean and Filby. Moles who'd penetrated the heart of British intelligence.
The enemy within, I think, was just a phrase that was used to describe people who had far more sympathy with the Soviet Union and its political motivations than they had with their own.
There's not much doubt in anybody's mind that the Russians are moving into a position of immense power.
At the time, I thought it was very, very serious. I bought the whole package, in fact, myself.
Angleton feared that the KGB had many other spies in Britain, and his fears began to fix on one man.
He seemed to know much more than he was telling me, but he was very interested in Wilson. There were sort of hints that there was something not quite kosher about Wilson, but he didn't tell me what those hints were until quite a bit later.
There was some method in Angleton's madness. A Russian defector, Major Anatoly Golitsyn, had told him of a KGB plan to assassinate a Western politician and secretly replace him with a Soviet puppet. Angleton and his MI5 friends had put two and two together and naturally concluded that the KGB had murdered the former Labour leader, Hugh Gaitskell, and put in their agent, Harold Wilson.
Russians had invited Gaitskell, who was then the leader of the Labour Party, over to Moscow for talks. And he was invited to attend the Soviet consulate. And while he was there, they served him tea and biscuits. Very shortly after that, he was taken ill. And he very soon after died from a condition which is rare in the Northern Hemisphere, called lupus erythematosus.
So once you assume that it is true that there was a murder, then was it Gaitskell? If all of that comes together and the answer to all of this is yes, then of course you would then look, well, okay, who is Harold Wilson? Here is a possibility. Let's have a look at it. it has to be done discreetly. Now, I think that all of the get-togethers of the people I know, the British and the British with us, it was understood that what we were doing and what we were saying was simply communicating, thinking about it, but strictly between us.
The spies chose not to confront Wilson about their suspicions, but he had no illusions about the secret warriors of the Cold War.
In fact, I have become quite concerned about one section of MI5.
Did you find any resistance from MI5, since you're not a conservative and most of them would be?
A very right wing. They're blinkered. They would naturally be brought up to believe that socialist leaders are another form of communist.
They would naturally be that, and of course many of them are brought up that socialist leaders is a communist.
A renegade section of MI5. A sensational story, if true. But like all good journalists, they had to ask, did they really believe their source? Maybe MI5 had good reason to be suspicious. They discovered that Wilson had been a frequent flyer to the Soviet bloc, along with a female companion.
Once upon a time, there was a tavern where we used to raise a glass or two.
And there were a lot of people then on the left who didn't understand how vulnerable they were to KGB spying and things like that, and getting themselves in compromised situations, this sort of honeypot idea. And the feeling was that they could then be put pressure on to start to reveal things.
It is very difficult to believe that countries that he visited didn't have a go at him, put it like that.
Peter Wright was to claim later on that there were a large number of officers in MI5 who believed that Wilson had been suborned and was a Soviet agent.
It was the number of times that he went. If he'd gone once or twice.
But lots of people go to the Iron Curtain all the time.
Yes, but you don't go and then become the Prime Minister of England.
I don't think the group were in any sense evil. They were people on the whole who followed a train of thought. The Russians used to try and entrap everybody. They must have tried with him. They must have succeeded.
Those were the days, my friend. We thought they'd never end.
The obvious reason to doubt Wilson was some dirty secret. His female companion was his political secretary. The gossip was they had been having an affair. Were they being blackmailed?
It may be that at some point while in opposition, he did or accepted something that worried him. His degree of nervousness about some exposure, whatever it might be, was blatant. He did not display the confidence of someone who knew this was all wrong.
You must take care.
The journalist's investigation into Wilson's possibly murky past was cut short.
No one must know that I am helping you.
An urgent call to a secret meeting with their source.
You yourselves should be on your guard.
See, Mr. Wilson. Thanks.
Something has happened. Something you should know about. Marcia's house has been broken into.
twice in the last few days. They stole a television set, as they did also a year ago. No, don't use this now, otherwise I'm going to get all the other journalists on the job.
No, this is back rent.
The interesting thing is that not one drawer was searched, in that a lady who had any jewellery or anything like that would keep it behind a nightie or something of that sort in a relatively harmless place. That's where you'd look if you were looking for anything valuable.
But they didn't.
Oh, they pulled out a drawer in a sort of routine thing, papers all over the place, no fingerprints. The police are checking.
It's not possible that it was just an ordinary burglary.
In the first 3 months of this year, leading up to my resignation, 5 of my staff were burgled.
So, in the first 5 months?
First 3 months, one was burgled twice. They took away, most improbably, an 8-foot grandfather clock. And all his papers were all over the place. Marcia's right-hand woman, Doreen, was burgled. Jean Denham in the private office at number 10. The burglaries were spread from Highgate to Eton and Islington, but not one of the other houses in their road were done. It's just possible that one of them was an ordinary crime, but the coincidence is too great.
So they were looking for something specific?
Marcia suspects that they were trying to put in bugs. It happened to a friend of hers, Jimmy Goldsmith, the businessman. He has a large number of buggers. I mean, debuggers. Not buggers. They're going to do my place in the country.
You think you're being bugged?
Let me show you something. I've had this specially installed. Looks like an ordinary cupboard, doesn't it? There should be no security problems now I've had this monster put in. It's one of the latest models and cost a pretty penny. Make sure your own security is as good. If you send me any documents, make sure the paper can't be traced back to you. Be careful of watermarks and so on. You must be on your guard. I have no doubt this is absolutely necessary.
Wilson was right. He was being bugged, and someone was looking for something.
I lived in Lord North Street, just 3 doors down, and the police came and asked us if we'd seen anything suspicious. And I recall one of the policemen saying it's a bit of a funny one, you know, nothing was taken.
The journalists themselves were targets.
In terms of your family, are we at risk? I had a briefcase stolen. That's never happened to me before. Why does it suddenly happen now?
They didn't even trust the safe in their BBC office.
A lot of the time, I was staggering around with 2 briefcases full of all the key documents and information.
Don't forget the tapes. We were so terrified about having them stolen.
Their safe contained not the tapes, but a decoy, a bottle of stout. And then disaster struck. Wilson said the clandestine meetings had been discovered. It was no longer safe for him to be their source, just as they'd become convinced of his credibility. The best he could offer was a meeting with his former political secretary, Marcia Williams.
They all meow about the ups and downs of all their friends.
She was a very, very devoted, loyal person. Wilson needed somebody who was unconditionally loyal and repaid it by probably putting up with temperamental outbursts. And her judgment was good when she could sum up situations and people extremely well.
She provided many of the aspects which he lacked. She was much tougher than him. He was a softie, really, and he didn't like being harsh on people, so he left her to do all of that, which she seemed to enjoy.
She would go down and eat with him in the members' cafeteria because nobody else would eat with him, so that he wouldn't sit there alone.
So, baby, stay and gab away, but hear me say that after girl, talk to me.
Thank you.
It was with great trepidation because her reputation was as quite a formidable protector of Wilson. And one sensed as we went, if she felt that we weren't good news, we would be out.
Hello. My name's Roger Courtier. This is Barrie Penrose.
So Harold sent you?
Yes.
Yes, he thought it would be good.
Look, how do I know what you're up to anyway?
Well, there's no answer to that, is there? But so that was the kind of difficulty that, and the frostiness in a way that was there when we first visited.
Well, you must ask the people around us. I mean, that's, you know that we've been journalists.
I'm sorry, I don't have the time.
No, I know, it's fine.
It's quite refreshing, actually. As most people don't actually say.
It was quite fierce, you know, like, how do I know, you know, that you're straight? You know, it was as simple as that, and she was very forthright, you know. Who are you? Why have you come?
Look, what's all this about, anyway?
Sir Harold, in fact, has given us a number of leads.
Try and start a debate about MI5.
MI5 are making a mockery of us. Those people ought to be exposed for what they really are.
That's right, but you can't, because
you can't identify them. We could be sitting in a room and you might be MI5 and I wouldn't know.
No.
Or I might have been all these years and you wouldn't know.
That was the point at which she began to relax a bit. The relationship did begin to work.
You know, Harold told me a hair-raising story the other day. It was about the Czech defector who has written a book or is writing
Jesse Frolic.
One. Yes, that's right. Harold said to me, do you remember, and I'd forgotten the Czech, but it was MI5 who came to Harold and said, we also have to report to you another known communist sympathiser and defector. And so he said, well, who is this? And they said, David Owen.
David Owen?
Yes, exactly.
The Parliament Secretary came in to tell him that there was a spy in the Labour Party and his name was David Owen.
He said, well, are you sure you've got that quite right? Oh, yes, they were quite sure it was David Owen.
He said, you can't be serious.
So he said, you do realise this is a man who's extremely right-wing and very safe in party terms.
It must have caused a certain amount of anxiety because I was Minister for the Navy and actually did know probably more than I should have done about Polaris and nuclear issues.
Oh no, they were quite sure. And then he said, just a minute, are you sure you don't mean Will Owen rather than David Owen?
Will Owen was a left-wing Labour MP.
Oh, yes, you're quite right, it's Will Owen. Well, now, there's a difference between Will Owen and David Owen, the now Foreign Secretary.
It was cock-up rather than anything else.
Talk to me.
Even after Will Owen was cleared of the spying charges, MI5 believed their informant when he went on to identify several trade union leaders as Soviet agents.
So, yes, it's true, one did believe them. If the intelligence people get it wrong, as they do from time to time, then the story at the end will be wrong, and people who believe it will probably take wrong actions as a result of it.
My experience with our security services was they were not very competent. I mean, in my policy unit, where they did their investigations, they objected to one person, and when I pressed them on it, they said, well, He does have a beard, and we've found you can't trust people with beards.
You think it's a just strike, do you?
Yes, I think it's a just strike, yeah.
In the late 1960s, industry contracted the British disease, industrial chaos, and an especially virulent strike by merchant seamen forced Wilson to devalue the pound.
Do you want to strike?
Yes, sure we do.
Some within the establishment were convinced that the Cold War was being waged on the home front.
Are you a communist?
Yes, I am, yes.
The Russians have some troops specially trained for sabotage, subversion, stirring up industrial unrest.
It was time to take on the enemy within.
From now on, the pound abroad is worth 14% or so less in terms of other currencies.
One of the rare occasions that Harold saw the people on the ground was when the seamen were on strike. The team came to tell him how they bugged everyone in the union and how they got tape recordings. Would he like copies?
The whole team came to see him.
Little men in black boots would come through quite regularly. Would you like a sandwich? They're cheese on it. Very interesting.
Oh, thank you. That would be lovely. That would be special branch.
That would be special branch, yes. And it was awful. Doors were locked. People went shh, were told not to speak to anyone. I mean, it was a very bad atmosphere. And I said, but we're right in the middle of Downing Street, right next to the cabinet room. If we have to do that here, then there's no hope.
The MI5 weren't just mad. I mean, you can see why they had their fears.
Oh, completely. And their fears are justified in that the communists have never succeeded in an election. They've always gone into the unions and had fairly successful infiltration in that way. That's not what frightens me. What worries me is the people who do become frightened of that, and then they think that something very scary is happening and take action on it.
Yes, of course.
If you took all that too seriously and acted on it, then you would make a right-wing regime happen in a very short time.
This was yet another great leap in a whole new area.
Was there ever any chance of that?
If I had to say which period we talked about guns the most, I would say it was after devaluation. It had become common knowledge that there was an awful lot of talk about coups.
A coup? I hadn't heard anything of this at all.
We had lived with a situation where a coup, the whole idea of a coup, was being bandied around.
Suddenly, Marcy was saying this was coming from the very top. This was people of immense power and wealth. They were frightened. They were frightened that these kind of unseen forces, people in country houses, people that had always been there with privilege and it was theirs by right, that they could still have one final throw, and maybe that would be when the tanks would appear on the lawn.
But I do remember the guns at number 10. Because Harold and I would discuss it often in the stateroom at the back. It would become our joke that the guns would be trained on us from Horse Guards Parade.
But you'd have been well looked after in the tower, nice apartments and so on. Nothing rough.
It would have been a very English coup. There wouldn't have been any bloodshed. They would have just been carted off to the tower and sort of kept.
I'd have quite liked that, actually.
We were beginning to get sort of concrete leads that could be followed through. They were baffling, but they could be followed through.
For us, the job was now, how do we put that together? Will anybody talk? Will any of the conspirators come forward?
Devaluation didn't go down well.
From now on, the pound abroad is worth 14% or so less in terms of other currencies.
Wilson relied on the Americans to support the pound and in return backed their unpopular war in Vietnam. As the left battled with police in Grosvenor Square, Wilson's establishment enemies reached for a remedy they'd already used abroad: regime change.
There was a sort of sense of despair. Tension over Vietnam, the collapse, apparent collapse of the economy, the sense of all the institutions, none of them working, Britain sliding forever further down every league table you could think of.
Now, if you were to get three or four Grosvenor-type demonstrations at the same time, on the same day, could the normal law forces of law and order deal with it?
When Wilson's talking about sort of how many bills he'd passed, they were all aimed at changing society in a very radical way.
Taxes, if at unimaginable levels now, the top rate of income tax was 98%.
What was needed was a strong leader. Lord Mountbatten, the Queen's cousin and recently retired Chief of Defence Staff, was actively seeking the job.
You know, we were losing the last bits of empire, Rhodesia. You know, a lot of people felt very strongly about that.
There were people talking about coup d'etats.
The government of the day wasn't doing the right thing by those people.
Lord Mountbatten was going to become head of some kind of junta which was going to rescue us and so on. Where was this going to end?
The former head of MI5 admitted to Penrose and Courtier that he knew about the coup talks. Their intelligence contacts even identified the conspirators.
They named names. Mountbatten was sort of going off to see the Queen Mother to get permission or blessing. Time for Wilson to go.
At last, they could report back evidence of the conspiracy.
Thank you for seeing us, sir.
You said you had something important.
We've spoken to some people, former British intelligence, and told us about the possibility of a coup because of your government, not because of you specifically. We've been told that Lord Mountbatten, the Earl of Cromartie, and others had gone to the Queen Mother to be the titular head of some interregnum. We've been given a whole number of names.
The idea that there would be support for a coup, is that strike you as absurd?
Surprises me. It doesn't necessarily strike me as absurd. The Queen Mother, of course, was the only member of the royal family who was privately very critical of the government.
And we've spoken before about Lord Mountbatten and Cecil King.
Yes, I spoke to Mountbatten's chief advisor, Solly Zuckerman. He was at the meeting with Cecil King. Zuckerman told me that Mountbatten ordered him out of the room.
We've evidence that a lot of people were talking about a coup. Was it a real threat?
I've often thought if you could get a few thousand men into horse guards, you could do a lot of damage before the troops came. If they came.
It wouldn't be difficult to have a couple of thousand in horse guards. They could do an awful lot of damage before the troops came in, if the troops...
The coup was aborted, partly because the Conservatives were becoming confident they could beat Wilson at the ballot box. Secret documents shown here for the first time reveal that the Conservative leader, Edward Heath, authorized a plan to be drawn up involving the armed forces in preventing Britain from becoming a communist police state.
But in the end, the democracy produced the counterweights, produced the new policies, which produced some kind of new solution, I'm happy to say.
So, in 1970, it seemed we had saved ourselves from communism. Wilson was out, and we had a man with a plan to defeat the enemy within.
People feel he's a man worth knowing.
The Heath government, which was elected in 1970, had defined itself almost as much, I think, in opposition to Wilsonism as in opposition to socialism. That is, it was going to be a completely different style of government. No spin, no nonsense, action, not words.
The moment he took office, he has followed a policy of provocative confrontation, calculated, contrived, set-piece slogging matches in order to buttress a disastrous and manifestly unworkable policy. There may be trouble
ahead. But Heath's confrontational policy hit problems. A miners' strike plunged the country into darkness. reducing industry to working a three-day week. Heath abandoned confrontation when police chiefs said they couldn't guarantee law and order.
And that, I think, was almost the key moment when the U-turn really began. It was the challenge to civil order, I think, as much as anything, which caused the Heath government to think we have to completely shift our ground.
To the dismay of many of his establishment supporters, Heath went to the country to win backing for his policy of trying to negotiate with the unions.
A kind of ripple went over the country of 1-2%. This is really a tiny movement of opinion, but a very vital one.
An election gives you, the people, the chance to say to the miners, we are all in the same boat, and if you sink us now, we will all drown.
Is this a campaign you're enjoying, or will you be glad when polling day comes around?
I'm enjoying it.
But you'll still be glad when polling day comes around?
Yes, because then we shall be back in office with an increased majority getting on with the job again.
The voters put Wilson back in office, but with no majority. He'd have to call another election. A shock result.
I don't think Wilson for a moment thought he was going to be elected in February 74. He was in an extremely jovial state that night, I think, having drank a good deal of brandy and not expecting to be summoned to form a government. So that there was a terribly difficult and muddly transfer of power, and again, a terrible feeling that things were just slipping out of control.
Some people on the right wing of British politics were afraid that the far left was taking over. After all, the Labour Party manifestos were getting more and more left-wing. More and more left-wingers were getting power and influence.
To the secret cold warriors, the voters had virtually handed Britain over to the communists. So they turned to a weapon they had used in other countries which had elected unpalatable governments. Black propaganda.
The intelligence community, I believe, felt that the government of the day was unable or unwilling to take the necessary measures to deal with the threat and the scale of the threat. And they believed that they were guardians of the United Kingdom. They felt that the political machinery was incapable of actually giving them support and introducing the policies that would enable them to deal with that threat.
A group of MI5 officers began feeding anti-Wilson propaganda to the press in time for the October election.
The real problem about the secret services, particularly MI5 at that time, was that there were quite a lot of people who were genuinely of the right, and quite extreme right. It's a bit in MI6, but mainly in MI5. And I think some of these people did have their own agenda and were very vicious about Labour politicians, and they tried to smear them.
In a typically establishment setting, Penrose and Courtieur discovered a smear campaign was underway. One of the guests, journalist Harry Chapman Pincher, had been asked to spread the story that Marcia Williams was a security risk. As the meal ended, Pincher was invited to speak.
Now, Harry's going to tell us all the latest gossip from Fleet Street. He's going to tell us all about Marcia. I didn't notice what was happening, but there was somebody taking a particular interest in this. A bald-headed chap in jeans, but I didn't know who he was.
Pincher was very... He was quite a charismatic person.
And he turned out to be a gentleman called Martin Gilbert.
He spoke almost conspiratorially. He was letting us into a very great secret. And if true, of course, it was a very great secret.
I told him all the Fleet Street rumours.
To reveal the most terrifying facts about the Prime Minister and about Marcia Williams, the Prime Minister's secretary.
The man Pincher failed to recognise was Winston Churchill's biographer, Sir Martin Gilbert. He has not spoken previously about witnessing the campaign to portray Marcia Williams as a threat to national security.
Of course, I've said publicly that the attacks on Jeremy Thorpe were all part of the attempts to undermine the Labour government. And they've got their connections in Whitehall.
There have also been allegations that your resignation and the Thorpe affair were closely linked.
They would have accused me of being his homosexual partner.
These more colourful allegations were that the Liberal leader Jeremy Thorpe had a homosexual affair with model Norman Scott. Thorpe convinced Wilson that this was all part of the smear campaign against Labour.
How did you pick up on the Whitehall connection?
Norman Scott's social security file went missing. Only a senior civil servant could have done that. But I think that file is existing still in some safe place. Check out that missing file. See what you find. Well, I'm here
looking through an old picture frame. The investigation suddenly caught fire.
The volume was overwhelming. It was just overwhelming, the quantity of material. And given that it was just Barrie and I, you have to come back from 5 or 6 hours of tape recording. Somebody then has to listen to that. Over this period, we must have done 18-hour days for how long? I mean, almost 2 years, to the point of being mentally, physically exhausted.
The journalists were becoming obsessed by the Thorpe story, but Wilson wanted the investigation to pursue another lead.
Do you have any contacts in Northern Ireland?
Yes, Roger and I spent quite some time there a couple of years ago.
It's important. A lot of the black propaganda against me and other Labour politicians was actually coming out of Northern Ireland.
Really, how would that happen?
It was coming out of this section of MI5.
MI5 had been running a black propaganda operation designed to undermine the IRA by planting stories linking them with the KGB. With Wilson still ahead in the opinion polls, the propaganda switched to suggesting that Harold Wilson supported IRA terrorism. Colin Wallace worked on the campaign for the Ministry of Defence.
The information that I received during leading to Harold Wilson related to political unreliability. It is quite clear that that information was designed not just to discredit him in a general sense, but bearing in mind that we were in a period running up to a general election, that information would most likely have had a fairly major impact on how the public viewed him.
Wallace was forced out when it was discovered he'd been the source of a leak to a Times journalist.
There's a man, a Ministry of Defence press officer. He was sacked when a leak on Northern Ireland was traced. An envelope was dropped through the letterbox of a Times journalist while he was away. A cleaning lady found it, thought it didn't belong there, and returned it to the Ministry of Defence. And they traced the leak to this press officer.
Well, we can certainly talk to some of our contacts in Northern Ireland about it.
The only problem was, of course, that we were getting on even faster with the Thorpe affair.
Yes, our travel budget is virtually gone.
Getting really quite concrete material and pointing us in a direction which wasn't the direction that we could sense. So Harold wanted us to go in, because it was coming all the time back towards Thorpe.
If Penrose and Courtier had traced Wallace, they could have exposed the MI5 operation, Wilson would have been vindicated, and they'd have been famous. But too late. Only now do they realize how close they were to this vital breakthrough.
I knew Roger Courtier from my time in Northern Ireland. So I suppose I would have felt free to have briefed them on most of the background to my resignation from the Minister of Defence.
The journalists missed the scoop and MI5 missed their target. Wilson stayed ahead in the polls and the black propaganda only increased fears among the establishment. And the fact that their share prices had halved didn't escape their attention.
I came back from a cruise down the Rhine. To my horror, I discovered that interest rates were 15% for 1 month certain. I discovered that the unions were striking again. The IRA were dropping bombs around. It was no longer a green and pleasant land, England. I thought the BBC would break down for one thing. I thought the trains would fail to run. London Airport would not function anymore. The ports would be stagnant. There would be complete chaos in the land. You know, the people in the City of London, they weren't liking it. And people who work as stockbrokers usually have come from the best schools, and a lot of them have titles, you know. They weren't liking it at all.
One of the main byproducts of the disinformation campaign in 1973-74 was the dramatic growth of paramilitary organisations in the United Kingdom.
We thought, therefore, that we must form some sort of organisation which would come in if the government fell.
Fearing Wilson was unable or unwilling to prevent anarchy, former military officers like General Walter Walker and Major Alexander Greenwood began to form private armies, thousands strong, to protect Queen and country.
The subject of the breakdown of law and order, when does it happen? I suppose some people say that it has already happened. Our own Prime Minister...
Many of these organisations were organised and run by very experienced, very patriotic people who genuinely believed that the system of law and order in the country was breaking down.
If you plot to destroy this present system, what are you doing? You are committing a form of treason. I have taken an oath of allegiance to my Queen, and I'm not prepared to see that oath interfered with.
I know the Queen. She wasn't very happy with Mr. Harold Wilson. There was not much she could do about it at that time. And Lord Mountbatten rang up General Sir Walter Walker one evening and said, if you want any help from me, will you let me know? General Sir Walter Walker had prepared a sort of speech which the Queen might read out on the BBC, asked the people to stand behind the armed forces as there was a breakdown of law and order and the government could not keep the unions in control.
What motivates us is purely patriotism. I've got awfully little faith in the present situation of Parliament as a whole, whether it's conservative or socialist.
Penrose and Courtier learned from the founder of the SAS, Colonel David Stirling, that the situation had become so serious that a military coup was again under consideration. Stirling planned to provoke the unions into a confrontation.
The leaders would suddenly start to go missing. He thought, let's attack the leaders, let's get them run over by a bus. Then they'll start thinking.
If a political strike is going to cause the country and the economy irreversible damage, we're there.
The idea of a preemptive strike against the possible assumption of power by someone else who wasn't elected. I mean, I would have regarded anything like that as a military coup and should be regarded as such.
Well, bearing in mind that these people were motivated for the real reasons, one can only surmise that the bulk of the information that they were reacting to was the disinformation which we and other parts of the government apparatus was producing at that stage. One of the other side effects of psychological operations is that once we actually created false information about an individual or an organisation, members of the intelligence community also believed it.
like the circle that you find.
Brian Crozier, a former intelligence officer, was one of those who began openly to try to enlist the armed forces.
I took it upon myself to make them understand the problems of communism and the problem that at some time or other they might even have to intervene in favor of destroying the communist danger. There was a sudden kind of absolute silence. They wanted to hear every word that I said. This was a problem that agitated them. The military people, I can't name any, who had seriously considered the possibility of a military takeover. This was quite a widespread attitude. They wanted to know whether there might be a time when the military had to intervene to prevent communism being imposed. And this is true. I'm not making it up.
Finally, the troops took to the streets. The public was told it was a routine anti-terrorist exercise at Heathrow. In fact, it was a show of force in response to alleged communist infiltration at the airport. The battle for Britain seemed about to begin.
And the first thing you do if you want to control a country is to take over the airports, take over the BBC, and protect Buckingham Palace with the Queen. If you've got those three things, you're pretty well in control, you know.
There was talk of coups, of some counter-revolution to throw Wilson and the Labour government out, and one heard that kind of chatter.
I still believe that operation they mounted at the airport, the one where everyone was so secretly briefed, which was, this is how you deal with terrorists. That wasn't an operation to deal with terrorists.
Of course it wasn't.
It was a rehearsal, nothing more. That was all the terrific mobilisation. The alert was on, all through Whitehall, right along the airport road, up and down, landing or getting out.
Nobody had given them any signal that this was coming. Home Secretary, whoever should have told them, they didn't know.
And I remember when that happened, Harold said to me, have you ever thought that all that could be used in a different kind of way? That they could be turned around? It's true. If they wanted to turn another way into something else, this sort of operation, they could turn. And you'd have a situation, a very frightening situation, where the alert could trigger a plan for a coup. It was very nasty to watch at the time. It was ghastly.
Were they top brass of the army?
Well, at the risk of making myself unpopular, I think the answer is yes. They were, but they didn't, well, for reasons which you and I can understand, they didn't want any of that to be made public.
If you're talking about the people who had a serious idea that there should be something like a military coup, yes, they would be fairly senior people.
But the confrontation at Heathrow didn't happen. Despite Lord Mountbatten's willingness to be the figurehead, the plotters never got their coup. The Ministry of Defence has so far neither named the senior officers involved nor officially disciplined them. After Watergate, the era of dirty tricks was over, officially at least. When some of his misdemeanours were exposed, James Angleton was forced out.
James Angleton, the hardliner, for 30 years the implacable opponent of communism, resigned from the CIA.
He and his fellow Cold Warriors in British intelligence were now officially disowned as a rogue element. Old and embittered, they had one last dirty trick up their sleeves. They would reveal that Wilson was a known Soviet agent. but had been protected.
Wilson would come up and at the height of it, we discussed how we could fix him, so to speak.
When you say fix him, what do you mean?
Well, get rid of him. A lot of people, in varying degrees, regarded him as a snake in the grass. An untrustworthy bastard.
Angleton claimed he had given proof of Wilson's treachery to the head of MI5, Sir Roger Hollis.
Angleton discovered that there had been a defector there who had actually stated that, in his view, Wilson had been got at by the Russians and recruited. This was reported to MI5. Hollis, who was then the Director General of MI5, they decided that they would not tell Wilson about it.
When they picked up this rumour, the journalists realised they would somehow have to ask Marcia Williams if she and Wilson had been having an affair.
It's a great embarrassment. It was just something that you didn't put to any lady.
What I don't understand is why MI5 would want to get at Harold and myself.
I mean, they want a Tory government back, obviously.
But the stories vary. I mean, there's a story that they're KGB agents.
Yes.
And we're being blackmailed. Well, now that's put about by people who have access to your files, who have vetted you and know everything about you.
Right.
Well, so why put that out when it's a deliberate lie?
Just have a certainty that it's true and that one day it will all come out.
You mean they really believe that they'll come up with the evidence?
We told you about the photographs. We've been offered photographs of you and Harold.
What are we doing?
Well, they wouldn't tell me what was in them. They're too terrible to talk about, but, you know.
Oh, you can't tell.
Well, you know.
We're living in a communist cell.
I think it's rubber dub time, actually.
Oh, pornographic. You mean we're not plotting in a corner with Khrushchev in one corner and Bulganin in the other?
I think it's a Russian bear hug.
Well, you can explain it all away by saying, oh, poor souls, are going off to Russia together, obviously the only place they can be together on their own, and then they get themselves into a compromising situation. And, well, you would have to be a nutter. You would have to be certifiable to actually plan to go to the Soviet Union. I don't know. Have you ever been there?
No.
It's such an uncomfortable place. I mean, no way could anybody be vaguely. I used to feel odd even in the shower. I mean, you are told you are being watched.
Certifiable is actually planned. Yes.
Your sense at the end was, if they hadn't had a fling at some point, human nature wouldn't be human nature.
The pictures were forgeries, but Wilson's constant fear was that speculation about the affair would in some way confirm the rumour that he was a spy.
If it were known that Wilson did, all he did was to masquerade as an ally, was in fact working in the interest of the Soviet Union. This is a terrible problem. It's a terribly dangerous situation. It was a very current topic of conversation. And the people concerned very often were either journalists or actually people quite high up in the intelligence service. I did tell Wilson and Marcia.
There is a story I should have told you.
They were shocked by it. It corroborated half a dozen or a dozen stories of similar kind heard before.
Last summer, would be July 1975, a group of Tory MPs told George Weidenfeld that there had been a house party.
It might have been the last but one straw.
During the course of the conversation, it was alleged that I
was a member of the Communist Party. And also that Marcia was a long-time member of the Communist Party. They were saying that I was tied up with the communists. And MI5 knew. MI5 was spreading the story that there was a communist cell in Downing Street. And the arch link was Marcia. She was supposed to be a dedicated communist. In fact, Marcia is rather right-wing. She's for pay beds and schools.
She's not a communist.
She's very Labour. But in no sense is she left-wing.
I think they both wanted, both Marcia and Harold Wilson, wanted revenge. They wanted revenge.
Unable to persuade the head of MI5 that Wilson was a spy, Angleton came to the conclusion that Hollis too was a communist spy. He made an unofficial but powerful contact.
I remember meeting in the mid-1970s. I was then known to be going out with Margaret Thatcher's daughter, Carol. And he then suddenly asked, could you get a letter to Mrs. Thatcher without it going through her private secretary? Angleton suddenly started to ask questions about whether or not Margaret Thatcher knew the whole truth about penetration of the security services in Britain. And he said, well, it could have gone as high as the director and deputy director of MI5. And it could have gone even higher, as high as the head of government.
The allegations about the head of MI5 and the so-called fourth man, Anthony Blunt, keeper of the Queen's pictures, also reach Wilson and Marcia Williams. Sensing that Penrose and Courtieur were struggling to prove the conspiracy, Marcia Williams took a huge gamble by giving them a final lead.
There's a story that Harold won't talk about. There's been a series of odd happenings lately connected with MI5. He was informed a few years ago there's someone at the very top of MI5 who's been accused.
Was it serious? The head of MI5 went communist and was just allowed to stay in office?
The whole thing is, I wasn't particularly shocked because it really got to people going around doing what these MI5 people did. I mean, it doesn't strike me as particularly shocking that someone would have gone the other way. I mean, I'm quite happy to think that the balance was retained. It would make me very nervous if I thought they were all going fascist.
And do you know who he is?
I don't know the details. Of course, their answer is, you know how difficult it is because it's another Philby situation. I suppose the argument against doing anything about the head of MI5 is that it will bring everything crashing down.
Are we talking about the fourth man?
No. But the identity of the fourth man would make your hair stand on end. Harold's quite convinced that the original culprit is already identified. And they're trying to get him out of the machine quietly and lose him. And they're worried and nervous. And Harold thinks the time is coming quite quickly now when someone's going to make a move. And he wonders if he should...
Should name the fourth man.
But if anyone were to identify the fourth man, I think the entire fabric of the establishment would collapse.
Could you give us a clue? An initial? Just an initial.
An initial.
Oh, what a hit we made. We came on next to closing. Best on the bill. Lovers.
between Z and C.
So we knew it was either A or B.
I should really have spotted that. So it's a major scoop that I'm afraid I missed, but it was part and parcel of the amount of raw information that was coming out hour after hour after hour, and it seems very silly now looking back that we missed it. But I'm afraid, you know, this was the way it happened.
The journalists had missed the fourth man because they had uncovered a sensational story about the Liberal leader. A tale told them by former MP Peter Bessel.
Well, we called Peter Bessel, and Bessel suddenly almost lost his temper with himself, where he said, "Do you know, I'm being asked about these questions about Jeremy Thorpe. I am fed up protecting him after all these years. Let me tell you something. It was a murder plot. He was obsessed by getting rid of Norman Scott." Well, this was an extraordinary development. We suddenly found that instead of possibly being a victim, Jeremy Thorpe was behind an alleged murder conspiracy of someone called Norman Scott. I mean, it wasn't presumably what Wilson had expected. And you can just imagine, for example, when we were meeting and they were asking, how is Jeremy getting on at the moment? I mean, are you finding out things showing he's being smeared? And one had to really bite one's tongue and change the subject.
Back at the BBC, this revelation met some internal resistance.
Increasingly senior and increasingly exasperated executives telling us they thought it was inappropriate and improper that we, as journalists, should be saying this sort of thing about Thorpe, who was a great leader of a great party. But we stuck to our guns, and eventually one morning went into work, and we were no longer employed at the BBC. And that was the way that they got rid of people they didn't want in those days.
At least they still had the tapes. They began writing a book which tried to explain what they knew about the conspiracy against Wilson amidst the lurid details of the Thorpe murder plot. But Wilson was to give them one further vital piece of information about the rogue element in intelligence.
I approached the head, the new head of the CIA.
George Bush.
George Bush, who had just come back from China. George Weidenfeld knew Bush. He'd met him before.
Yes, you said?
Bush is in there as the CIA's Mr. Cleanup. What he seems to be doing is clearing up the private enterprise side of the system. Blackmail and so on.
He said, could you, when you were there, find out answer to various questions about the rumors that are being circulated about me. So I went to see him.
But he couldn't confirm any of my cases of burglaries.
Did he say it wasn't dirty tricks?
He just said he didn't know one way or the other.
So you just drew a blank?
When I heard what was going on in MI5, I called in Oldfield, the head of MI6.
Maurice Oldfield?
Yes. Oldfield said that there was a section of MI5 that was unreliable. Oldfield confirmed this and said he would bring it out.
Sorry, but Oldfield confirmed this and he said he was going to bring it out.
And?
And I never heard any more. That was the day I went on holiday. August 1975.
You never heard any more?
He said, there is this group.
Why now?
The showdown with the intelligence chiefs brought no response. After waiting 6 weeks, Wilson gave the first formal indication of his intention to resign. The journalists had to tell Wilson that their investigation couldn't reveal the full details of the conspiracy against him, but would put the man he'd wanted to help on trial for murder.
What Wilson had started, along with Marcia later, was actually pushing Jeremy Thorpe into the court number one at the Old Bailey. That's what we were concerned about.
If we go back with the wrong news, will they stand behind us?
Come this way, we don't have very long, Kate. Roger's wife's expecting a baby. Isn't that splendid, producing a baby and a book?
You're publishing on Monday?
Yes, it's now very serious, conspiracy to murder.
Mm. And because of my friendship, as it was, with Thorpe.
You can see why some people might say that the Prime Minister was involved.
Well, I mean, the short point is that I was involved with Jeremy. Very much in what I believe to be the subject.
I think people will see Harold as naive for not realising that all this was going on.
Whether Jeremy was involving me himself, knowing there was a murder plot already on, well, that...
Well, we know we must have become a terrible embarrassment to you because of... you seem to have found the wrong hair.
We all chased the wrong hair.
The actions of Lord Mountbatten, senior military and intelligence officers, undermined democracy and brought this country to the brink of a coup. Yet no one has been held accountable. There has been no proper inquiry. When a senior intelligence officer confirmed Wilson's allegations, MI5 conducted its own internal inquiry and pronounced itself innocent.
I think the reason why the inquiry drew a blank is because the rogue element in MI5 had been very careful to leave no fingerprints. After all, the head of MI5 did apologise to Harold Wilson for their activities, and yet their activities have gone. Nobody seems to know anything about them. And I think Wilson is vindicated in his concerns. Something wrong really did happen, and he was a victim of it.
Evidence has emerged since that there were people who discussed getting rid of the Labour government in that kind of way. So it wasn't foolish to be worried about that, not foolish at all.
BBC2 tomorrow, a story that raises profound questions about what it is to be human. The family that walks on all fours is at 9. And James Bowler will be back on BBC One with some new tricks this Saturday at 9:15. Next tonight, it's Question Time on BBC One shortly, and Newsnight is here on BBC Two.